to God, who is my life. It is through him that we live, we move, and have our beings. We give honor to Jesus the Christ, who is and he always will be the great head of the church. We give honor to the Holy Spirit, who is my comforter and my guide. We give honor to Elder Evans, Elder Bradley, Elder Williams. We give honor to our motherboard, to our very powerful deacon staff. We give honor to each of you inside the sanctuary and those of you that are in the parking lot. We give honor to you. Certainly give honor to my own family. Amen. Especially my very lovely wife, whom I thank God for every day of my life. There is a word from the Lord this morning, and I'm so glad that you're here. I'm so glad that you're here. Amen. If you brought your Bibles, turn with us now to the book of Philippians, chapter 4, beginning at verse number 10. Philippians, chapter 4. We began reading at verse number 10. We'd like to read verses 10 through 13 for your understanding. When you find it, I'm certain you'll find these words recorded. But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly, that now at the last your care of me flourished again, wherein ye were also careful, but you lacked opportunity. Now that I speak, not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I am instructed, both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. We like to offer for a subject taken from these passages and other supporting passages of Scripture. Hallelujah, anyhow. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah, anyhow. Amen. Hallelujah, anyhow. Yeah, I think I ought to tell you from the very beginning that particular scripture, it means what it says, but it doesn't say what it means. So I have an assignment today to tell you what it means. Now it means what it says. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. But I gotta tell you what it meant. Amen. You know, I have a great task this morning, and my task this morning is to show you how to live a life of contentment. A lot of people don't know how to live a life of contentment, how to be content. I have come to realize that life happens. And there's no way around trials and tribulation.
That's right.
Some people don't know how to deal with their problems.
Yes,
others have been taught, but it didn't take root. So they still don't deal with them correctly. But because of all the heartaches and disappointments, the sickness, the falling away, that I see from God's children. Not speaking about the sinners, I expect sinners to do certain things, but not God's children. But because I see these things happening in God's children's life, I come to encourage you. The Lord has sent me this morning to teach you two words. Hallelujah, anyhow. Hallelujah, anyhow. Now I think I ought to tell you, it's important to use those two words together when we use them, especially when you're going through something, when you don't know what to do. Why, Lacey? Why? Because when you say hallelujah anyhow, you're telling God and the saints that even though you're struggling with the situation, you know God is still in control. Yeah, not only that, but you're telling God and you're telling the saints that you're going to praise God anyway. Yeah, not only that, but when you say the words hallelujah anyhow, you're telling Satan, I see what you're trying to do, but my God will make a way somehow. Yeah, we got to learn how to say hallelujah anyhow. Yeah. Saints, we got to learn how to trust God even when we can't trace him. Yeah. See, you can trace a cell phone. My wife's cell phone was left on the car and we lost it and couldn't find it that night. And Myra, with her smart self, said, well, we can trace the phone. I said, how you going to trace a phone? Yes. In some kind of way, the thing came up on the phone, and it showed me where I was, and it showed me exactly where the phone was. Yes. The next morning, me and my wife went out there and found the phone on the side of the road. Yes. So you can trace some things, but you got to trust God when you can't trace him. When you don't know where God is, you still got to trust him. Oh, I know the Lord is all right. Can I just remind you that he watches over us all day and all night? Yes, he does. And as we get ready to unpack our text this morning, I first want to tell you what Webster said about the word hallelujah. According to Webster, it says to express praise, joy, or thanks, a shouting or a song of praise or thanksgiving. That's what hallelujah means. And we know hallelujah is the highest praise to God. We already know that. Yeah. And then I looked in Webster because I wasn't sure that anyhow was a word. But anyhow is in the dictionary. It's a word. And Webster said it means at any rate, in any manner, or whatsoever, any kind of event. So when I put those two together, hallelujah anyhow, that means that I'm going to praise God no matter what. Hallelujah anyhow. Yeah. As we look at our lesson now, if anybody had a reason to say hallelujah anyhow, it would be Brother Paul, the Apostle Paul. Paul had been through so much in his life. This man had been beaten with rods 3 times. He had been shipwrecked 3 times. Yeah. He had been in prison frequently. He was faced with death often. Paul had been stoned. Paul had been snake bit. But Paul said, after all I've been through, I still got my joy. Can anybody here say that this morning? I know the Lord is all right. In fact, Paul said, I count it all joy. Paul was still shouting, hallelujah, anyhow. Yeah, church, I just like for you just to think back in your own mind of all the things that you've been through, of all the trials and tribulation, all the trouble that came in your life. I just like for you just to think about it, just reminisce a minute on how far God has brought you. And then when you think about it, I have to ask you, are you angry that God allowed you to go through it, or can you say hallelujah anyhow? Yes, sir. You ought to be able to say hallelujah anyhow. Thank God I'm still here. Yes, sir. In Philippians chapter 4, verse number 10, Paul acknowledged that they, the Philippians, were concerned about his needs all along. He acknowledged it, and I'm leading to something to explain to you what I talked about in the beginning about what that scripture meant and how it came about. So Paul acknowledged to the Philippians that I know that y'all were concerned about me all along, but you lacked opportunity. You didn't have a chance to really do for me what you wanted to do. That's what Paul said. Yeah. And you do know it really makes a pastor or a preacher feel good to see his church showing him love. And that doesn't mean all the time monetary love. You know, a pastor appreciates just a phone call every now and then with words of encouragement. A pastor appreciates a text every now and then checking on him. And I got to say, Randall is very good at checking on their pastor, and I thank God for you. But don't get me wrong, monetary gifts will also make a preaching pastor smile. Yeah, I ain't saying that I don't need no money, but I'm just saying it ain't always about money. But Paul here had to clear the air, church. Paul had to clear the air. Because some people think that if you stop giving, the pastor gonna stop living. That's what some people really think. Some people don't pay towards the ministry because they think it hurts the pastor's progress. And Brother Paul kept it real. He kept it real. But before I tell you what Brother Paul said, let me tell you what Lacey says, and I got it on good authority. So I'm just not speaking what I think. I got it on good authority from the Lord. When you give your tithes and your offerings, you cause God to open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you don't have room to receive. That's when you pay your tithes and offerings. But if you don't pay, eventually all the blessings you have, you're going to lose them.
Yes, sir.
I'm just telling you.
Yes, sir.
So it's on you to do the right thing. You ain't hurting the pastor if you don't do what's right. You're hurting your own self. And Paul had to clear the air. Paul, listen. Paul said, for those 10 to 12 years that y'all stopped giving, he said, I never stopped living. He said, God supplied all of my needs. Anybody know God will supply your need? Whatever you need, God will supply your need. The Bible never said why the Philippians stopped supporting Paul. Uh-huh. Maybe some of them thought that because Paul had a nice automobile, he didn't need the money. Maybe they thought because Paul had a nice home or had a good paying job. I'm just putting it in today's terms.
Yes,
yeah. Maybe they thought that because Paul had all of those things that he didn't need the money. So it didn't say why they stopped supporting him. But we know they stopped.
Uh-huh.
But you know what's really sad?
Yes, sir.
Some members, I ain't talking about random now, but some members at some churches, some church folk don't like to see their own pastor living well.
Yes,
they'll stop paying if the pastor drive up on the lot in a new car. Yeah. But as soon as trouble comes their way, as soon as they need the pastor to rush to the hospital, as soon as they need him to rush to their home, they don't want to hear no excuses like my car wouldn't crank.
All right.
I found out something. If you pray for rain, you better be ready to deal with the mud that come with it.
Right.
Yeah. Folks don't want to hear no excuses. They want you there. Now, if you truly love your pastor, you really don't want to see him putting around in a hootie riding through Edwards, Mississippi with mismatched doors on the car, do you? If you really love your pastor, you don't want to see him traveling like that. Now, if you truly love your pastor, you don't want to see him living in insufficient living quarters. You don't want to see him living in a house that's insufficient. Yeah, he should have comfort in his home so that he can keep his mind on studying God's word and not on leaks coming through the roof, not on watching his steps so he don't fall through the floor. You ought to want him to live in a home of comfort so he can concentrate on what God wants him to do for his people. Because men, I gotta tell you, the pastor don't get no pass if it's 100 degrees and the air conditioner go out. The pastor don't get no pass on that. Well, baby, you know you the pastor, and I know it's hot in here. We'll be all right. Oh, no, that ain't what you're going to hear. You're going to hear something different. You're going to have to get that air fixed.
That's right. Glory.
So you ought to want the pastor to live in comfort so that he can do what God wants him to do. So when I look at Paul's situation, I find out that Paul had much greater problems than we have. Yeah, but the answer to Paul's problem was the same as it is to our problem. And the answer to Paul's problem is still the same today, yesterday, and forevermore. The answer to his problem and to our problem is Jesus. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him, there's no other. Jesus is the way. I know I'm right about it. Yeah. Listen, in our text today, Paul was in prison, and he was facing the death sentence on false charges for rebelling against the Roman government. Paul was on death row. Yeah. And in our text, we have heard, now we've heard that that he was on death row, and what made the Philippians go to Paul was they heard that Paul was not only on death row, but they heard that Paul was still holding fast to his faith, and Paul was still preaching to everybody that came to visit him. And when they heard that Paul was doing these things, that they sent one of the servants from the church to minister to Paul and to bring some funds to Paul. So a lot of people don't really realize that when you're in prison, you still need funds. A lot of people don't know that when you're in prison, the government don't give you everything you need. But you wouldn't know that unless you go visit folks that's in jail sometime. No pun intended, but I'm just saying, that's the only way you'll know. Because a lot of people think that the prisoners get everything that they need. But they don't. Good God Almighty. Paul was so gracious and so kind that even though they had went all them years without supporting him, Paul didn't even ask them, why did y'all stop giving? And the pastor shouldn't, and Lacey don't ask nobody why you stopped giving. Because that's not my problem. That's going to be your problem in God. You got to deal with God, not me. So when you stop giving, you can just look for God to deal with you.
Yes, sir.
So Paul didn't go there with them. He was really gracious and kind to them. The first thing, Paul let them know that he rejoiced in the Lord greatly when he saw that they had started back again, showing him love through their giving. Yeah, Paul was... He was so happy about it. He said, I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care for me have flourished again, wherein you were also careful, but you lacked opportunity. He said, you started back again, and I rejoice about that. But I want you to look at verse number 11. Paul said, I don't want anything. He said, I'm not speaking in terms of want. I don't want anything from you. But Paul said, I'm glad to see you showing me love again, but during those 10 to 12 years that you close your purses, that you fold your wallet up, and you didn't give me anything, Paul said, I had to learn something. Paul said, I had to learn something from God. And Paul said, I learned how to say hallelujah anyhow. Yeah. When folks refuse to help you, when they know you need help, you need to learn how to say, that's all right, hallelujah, anyhow. Ain't the Lord all? Ain't he all right? Paul said, I learned whatsoever state I am in, therewith, and therewith means with that. He said, I learned how to be content. Yeah, no matter what, preacher, we got to learn how to be content. Church, I found out something. Now, I found this out just through watching folks, just through life experience. I found out something about Christians. That's one of the hardest things for a Christian to do, is to be content. Yeah, I found out that most Christians are never satisfied. You give them cake, they gonna say, I want some ice cream with it. You give them a house, they gonna say, well, I want a mansion. You give them a job, they gonna say, I wanna be the boss. They just ain't satisfied. You give them a good wife, they gonna want a girlfriend with it. You give them a good husband, they still gonna want Jody on the side. But Paul said in verse number 12, he said, I know how to be abased, which means I know how to have very little. I know how to handle when I got low esteem. A low self-esteem. Paul said, I know how to be abased. But thanks to God, he said, I also know how to abound. That word abound means to have an overflow of blessings, of great qualities, to have many, many things. Paul said, I know how to be abased and I know how to abound. He said, I don't worry about anything. I've learned how to shout hallelujah anyhow. Paul said, everywhere I go and in all things, I am instructed. Y'all know who instructs him? Jesus. Jesus instructs you and I. Paul said, I have been instructed both how to be full and how to be hungry. Yeah. Paul don't worry about it. He don't worry about this fleshly body here. He said, I know how to handle situations when I'm hungry. I know how to handle it. When I'm full, I know how to handle it. He said, both to abound and to suffer need. He said, I know how to do these things. He said, while y'all were gone, while y'all left me out here by myself, when I was looking for help every week and y'all stopped helping me, Paul said, I had to take another direction. I had to turn to Jesus. He said, so I didn't learn these things. Good God Almighty. In other words, when man reaches his extremity, that's God's opportunity. Yeah, God will take care of his servants. Even if the church doesn't adequately take care of them, God gonna take care of them. You do remember how God took care of Elijah, don't you? He told Elijah where to go. He said, Elijah, now, I know that you ain't working. I know that you ain't got no freezers full of food. He said, but I got some work I need you to do for me. He said, I want you to go. And when you go, he said, I'm going to instruct the ravens to bring you meat and bread in the morning. He said, and in the evening time, I know you're going to need to eat before you go to sleep. I'm going to instruct the ravens to bring you meat, bread in the evening, and you can drink water from the brook that I have provided for you. Won't God make a way out of no way? Won't he do it? If mankind won't help you and God needs you, God will make a way for you. Don't put your trust in no man. He'll fail you every time. So I question pastors who walk away from churches because they feel like they ain't getting paid enough. I just question pastors that do those kind of things. Yeah. God said, work in my vineyard, and whatsoever is right, God said, I'll pay. You ain't got to be looking for the members to pay. God said, I'll pay whatsoever is right. Now, just in case somebody's wondering, well, Lacey, how do you personally feel about that situation? In case you're wondering, because I don't talk about it much, but in case you're wondering how I personally feel about it, I just believe that if the church is doing well, the pastor ought to be doing well. I believe that if the church prospers, the pastor ought to prosper. Yeah. But as long as I live, you'll never hear me ask for money. You'll never hear me ask for a raise. But listen, I don't believe that you ought to muzzle the mouth of the ox that shredded out the corn. I don't believe you ought to do that. You ought to let him eat too. Ain't the Lord all right?
Yes, Lord.
Even animals ought to be treated right.
That's right.
And church, I don't know how you feel, but I believe that you feel the same way about yourself and the company that you work for. I believe that if the company is doing well and they ain't shutting down, I believe you're expecting a raise, aren't you?
Yes, sir.
And listen, if you ain't working now, you retired. When you was working, you was expecting that.
Yes, sir.
I want to talk about 3 points that Paul made in verse number 12. Listen, even if you're not a minister, this message applies to every servant of God. Point number one, giving is not necessary because God teaches his servants how to be content no matter what the circumstances are. So don't think that that's the only way that you can make it if somebody give to you, because you can still make it. You can make it when you trust in the Lord. And Paul wanted to make that point. The word content means to be self-sufficient or to be completely detached from your circumstances. But now I think I ought to tell you, you can't get this from a book, but I think I ought to tell you that to be content, it's a learned experience from God. And Paul had to learn, and so must we. We must learn how to conquer our circumstances and not let our circumstances worry us to death. And that's what I hate to see, is Christians letting their circumstances worry them to death. Don't you know worry is a sin? I know the Lord is all right. Now people are going to think you crazy, but that's all right. Do what the Lord say do. So that was the second point, that it's a learned experience from God. The third point that Paul wanted to make was, now what I'm about to tell you now is all spiritual and not physical. Saints, in times like these, I got to tell you, we're about one president away from going back into slavery. Yeah, we're about one president away, and y'all know what I mean, from going back into slavery. Therefore, we must learn how to abase. What that mean, Lacey? That means to live humbly with a little bit. You got to learn how to live humbly with just a little bit. Yeah, don't complain, but be humble with what God has blessed you with. You got to learn, you can't be keeping up with the Joneses. Yeah. We must learn how to abound. That means that don't get the big head just because you got a wallet full of big head hunters. Yeah, don't get the big head because you got plenty. That word abound means that you got plenty. You can live with plenty and you're very prosperous. But you got to learn how to live like that. And then we got to learn the secret to every situation. Whether we're being full or whether we're going hungry, there's a secret to it. I heard Paul say in another situation, Paul said, I think myself happy. Yeah, when you hungry and you got no food in sight, it's a spiritual thing. You got to think yourself full. You got to think yourself full. You can't quit on God because you say, I ain't ate nothing all day long.
All right.
It's spiritual.
Yeah.
This is spiritual. Spiritually speaking, Jesus once told his own disciples when they were starving to death and they needed to eat, Jesus said, y'all go on to town and buy some food.
Okay.
And when they came back, they said, Master, eat. You ain't ate nothing either. Jesus said, I got meat that y'all know nothing of.
Yes,
it's spiritual food. You got to learn how to deal with being hungry and how to deal with being full. So when you can't find food all day long, you still need to shout hallelujah anyhow. Yeah, did you know that the human body can live up to 2 months without any food. As long as you got enough intake of water, you can live up to 2 months without food. And some people ain't gonna go 4 hours without a piece of chicken. They gotta have something. But I gotta tell you, you ain't got to have that. If the situation arise and you don't have it, you still gotta serve the Lord. And you gotta learn how to shout hallelujah anyhow. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. Glory be to God for making our bodies. Our bodies is self-sufficient. God made us that way. This body here, if I get a cut on it, if I just watch it a few days, that cut gonna start healing itself. Yeah. We made special, y'all. We are amazing. Our body is amazing. Yeah. And we can do all things through Christ, which strengthens us. Ain't the Lord all right? Paul also said, I know how to abound, to live in plenty. And he said, I know how to suffer. Means I know how to go without. Yeah. Yeah. It's proven, y'all, that we also know how to go without. We have been involved with catastrophic storms where all of our power has gone out. We couldn't get no water. We couldn't bathe. We have learned how to deal with situations that we thought we couldn't deal with. So we have learned how to suffer. And as children of God, you got to learn how to suffer. Our foreparents had such a close relationship with God until they already knew these things that I'm telling you now. They didn't complain when they didn't have. They knew the Lord would make a way. All of their trust was in God. If they had plenty, they knew how to share with you. And they didn't walk around bragging about what they had. They would help the less fortunate ones. I know the Lord is all right. Well, Lisa, how did Paul learn all of these things? How did he learn all these things? Well, can I tell you that this lesson on life only comes from God through his son, Jesus Christ. Everything that Paul talked about here, I personally have learned. But I really didn't learn it until I retired and had to depend solely on God. I just thought I knew some of that stuff, but I really didn't learn it until I retired. And when I retired, I had to depend on nobody but the Lord. I wasn't getting no bi-weekly check coming in. Yeah, you already know, I've told this story, but you already know I retired at an early age at 55 to become a full-time pastor. Which means now, if I retired at 55, that means that I'm still not eligible for Social Security. Yeah, I still can't draw. I can't draw Social Security until I turn 62. Yeah. And I can't draw my retirement. I got some retirement up from when I was working, but I can't touch it until 59 and a half. So that'll be next June. I can start drawing that. But can I tell y'all something? Out of all that time, Pastor Lacey and Sister Lacey have not went lacking for not one thing. God has supplied all of our needs. I learned how to shout hallelujah anyhow. Yeah. Yeah, I learned how to be instructed by God on how to live with a little. Yeah. And I learned how to handle being full. In the days I was hungry, I learned how to be hungry. And I learned how to suffer. And believe me, I have suffered for the Lord. But he told me that I got to suffer, because if I don't suffer, I won't gain eternal life. And I don't know about y'all, but I want to gain eternal life. Jesus said, if you don't suffer with me, you can't reign with me. And I want to reign with him. Yeah, I heard Paul say it best in Romans chapter 8, verse 18. Paul said, for I reckon that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Yes, so I don't even worry about the suffering that I'm going through now, because it don't even compare to the good things that God has in store for you and I. But my question to the church this morning is, have you learned how to live without depending on people? Yes, Lord. Yeah. Have you learned how to suffer? Have you learned the same lesson that Brother Paul learned? Yes, sir. Have you learned? learn that you're going to have some good days and you're going to have some bad days. But you need to shout hallelujah anyhow. Have you learned that my God will supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus? Have you learned how to look toward the hills from which cometh your help? Because all of your help coming from the Lord. I can hear Paul saying, I've learned so many things in life. I can hear Paul saying, I've learned that Jesus is my only friend. I can hear Paul saying, I've learned that I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. And I don't know about you warriors, but I got to have Jesus. Because I just can't make it by myself. I need the Lord every second. I need him every minute. I need him every hour. I need him every day, every week, every month, and every year. I got to have it because I just can't make it by myself. I heard God say, I'll be there for you. I'll hold you in my arms. Ain't it all right? He said, if you're dealing with some things that's causing you pain, you know all you got to do is call him. Anybody know he will come to your rescue? Saints, I come to encourage you this morning to hold on to God's unchanging hand. God won't, he won't ever leave you, nor will he forsake you. Ain't he all right? This is Cancer Awareness Month, but I stop by to tell you, if cancer has invaded your body, you ought to shout hallelujah anyhow, because God has, he has the last word. Ain't he all right? When you feel like the weight of the world is on your shoulders, shout hallelujah anyhow. I'm reminded of a song by Clay Evans. He said, hallelujah anyhow. Don't let your troubles get you down. If Satan block your way, stand right up and say, hallelujah, anyhow, ain't it all right? We must learn how to be content in whatsoever state we are in. If God brings us to it, he can take us through it. I wish I had a witness here. Church, we're living in difficult times. We're living in a time of insecurity. We're living in a time when we don't know if we're going to have a job tomorrow. We don't know if we're going to continue to pay our bills. We don't know if COVID is going to attack our family. We're worried about our health and strength. We're worried about our children, well-being. We're worried about the trials of this life. But I stopped by this morning to encourage you. I want to teach you two words. These two words will give you joy in time of sorrow. These two words will give you hope for tomorrow. You need to learn the two words, hallelujah, anyhow, any all right. When you're worried or feeling low, when you're going through what God allows, you need to shout, hallelujah, anyhow, any all right. When you're down to your last dime, when you can't see your way, when your body is racking in pain, and it seems like nobody seemed to care, I promise you, if you learn how to shout, hallelujah, anyhow, the Lord will, he'll come to your rescue, he'll show up, and he'll do it on time. I I wish I had a witness here. Can somebody say, will he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? I can hear you saying, well, Pastor Lacey, what's so special about hallelujah? Well, I'm glad you asked. When you shout hallelujah, you're not only giving God the praise, but you're giving him the highest praise. Ain't he all right? Anybody here know he's worthy to be praised? I promise you, and I got it on good authority, if you learn how to say hallelujah anyhow, when trouble comes in your life, on every side, you won't be distressed. Whenever you get perplexed, you won't be in despair. I've learned how to shout hallelujah anyhow. When you're persecuted, the Lord won't forsake you. You might get cast down, but you won't be destroyed. Ain't he all right? Hallelujah anyhow. I wish I had a witness here. Can I tell you, whatever you're going through, he's water in dry places. He's bread in a storming land. He's shelter in a time of a storm. I heard Paul said, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. No matter what it looked like, you still ought to rejoice. Ain't all right. Be careful for nothing, but in all things, through prayer and supplication, make your request made known to the Lord. Tell God about it, and he will. He'll make it all right. Anybody here know him? When you ought to be crying, you ought to shout hallelujah. When you feel like giving up, you ought to shout hallelujah anyhow. Ain't he all right? Good God Almighty here. Church, if you learn how to shout hallelujah anyhow, the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will keep your hearts and mind through Christ Jesus. You ought to tell the world, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. I don't know about you, but I feel all right right now. I feel like going on. I feel like serving the Lord. I feel like doing the Master's will. He's been good to me. He's been mighty nice to me. Have I got a witness here? Have God been good to you? Ain't he been good to you? You ought to shout hallelujah. Anyhow. No matter what you're going through, shout hallelujah anyhow. Give God the praise. Show the Lord that you trust him. Show God that you love him. Stand on his word. Shout hallelujah anyhow. Doors of the church is open. Will there be one? Will there be one? Might not know the Lord in the pardon of your sins. Today is your day. You don't have to worry about the trials and tribulations. You don't have to worry about the things going on in this world. You just need to learn how to shout hallelujah anyhow. You need to learn how to give God the glory. He'll make a way for you. When folks don't want to help you, God will help you. I found out something. He's a friend. And Elder, he's a friend that sticks closer than any brother. He'll be there for you. You may come by ladder baptism or by Christian experience. You ought to give your life to him this morning. He gave his life for you and I. Out of all I've been through, and y'all don't know the half of it, just like I don't know the half of what y'all been through. But out of all I've been through, I still got my joy. Oh, I still got it. I still got it, Sims. I still got my joy. I still can shout hallelujah anyhow. When folks told me you ought to just give up, I said, I ain't giving up on God. Hallelujah anyhow. You ought to give your life to him, children. Today is your day. Today is your day. Yes, sir. times, the Lord made a way for me. Has he done it for you? So many times, the Lord made a way for me. I dare you to think back over your life. I dare you to think back when they put stumbling blocks in your way. When they wanted to see you fall. Turn that up, brother, please. Yeah, I got to hear that. Did he do it for you? Place. Yeah, the Lord did that for me. Did he do it for you? Yes, Lord. Not just one time, Elder. If I had 10,000 tongues, I couldn't thank the Lord enough. Woke up in the morning sometime with dried up tear stains on my eyes. Well, I had to cry all night long. Oh, yeah. Somebody here been sick. Thought they wasn't gonna get well. What did he do for you? Heal this old body. Won't he do it? Won't he will? Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Over and over again. Yeah. This thing is personal. Has he made a way for you? It's personal. I don't know about you, but I got a right to tell God thank you. Yeah.
Ain't he been good to you? Ain't he
ain't God been good to you? Anybody gonna shout hallelujah anyhow? No matter what you're going through, shout hallelujah anyhow. We thank God for you being here. We thank God for your presence. We thank God for you being a witness to the word. And at this time.